We've talked about many methods for learning about causality. Well, in the past 20 or 25 years, there's been a debate about which of these methodologies is the best. And generally, people are split into two camps. Over here in the first camp, we've got people who like randomized experiments, instrumental variables, regression discontinuity, and differences in differences. While over here in the other camp, we have people who like discrete choice analysis and analysis that uses models of the system like macroeconomics and climate change. This group is typically called structural methods, while this group is typically called the reduced form methods. Now, the structural people argue that there are many situations that just can't be handled, can't be analyzed using reduced form methods. Things like climate change. We don't have a natural experiment for that, but we care about it. Things like macroeconomy. We want to learn about the effect of stimulus, but where is your instrumental variable? Where is your differences and differences? You can't do that, but we care about this. So they argue that by restricting your attention to just a few methods, you're going to rule out a whole bunch of policy questions that we care about, we want to learn. Another criticism they'll give, that the structural people will say, is that you're going to just use the easiest method instead of picking the most appropriate methodology. Okay, for example, think about non-compliance in randomized experiments, like the Oregon healthcare experiment. Well, often, a reduced form people, like in the papers you can read, will just give IV estimates, the instrumental variables. Now, we already saw that the instrumental variables estimator is going to give us the local average treatment effect. That's the average treatment effect for a subset of people, okay? But why do we care about average treatment effects for just them? What about everybody else? Don't we care about the overall average treatment effect? Well, if you do a little bit more structural analysis, we can learn that the average treatment effect is in bounds. We can't learn it exactly when there's non-compliance, okay? We can only learn that it's in an interval. So these reduced form guys sometimes ignore that point and just report the local average treatment effect estimate instead of giving you the bounds analysis. So the structural guys will say, you're letting your methods dictate what we're interested in and not letting the problem and the economic situation hand dictate what we're interested in. Now, on the flip side, the reduced form guys will say, but look, you're going to have to make a huge amount of assumptions in order to make any of those conclusions you're trying to do. If you want to learn about climate change, you've got to say that you know everything about how the world global weather system works. And if you want to know about the effects of some stimulus package, you got to know everything about how the government interacts with the private sector, interacts with the nonprofit sector, interacts globally with all countries across the world, etc. That's a lot of assumptions, and I don't believe them. And if I don't believe your assumptions, then I don't believe the conclusions you're drawing from them. So while I find your policy question interesting, I just don't believe your methods because I don't believe your assumptions. So these are the kinds of debates that people have been having. Well, in my opinion, the best thing to do is just to say, look, none of these methods are at the top of the hill. None of them are the king. None of them are queen. We should be pluralistic and take all of them into account and try to use everything that's every tool we've got at our disposal to understand the questions we're interested in.